Hi, I'm Riccardo, and in this presentation I'm going to talk to you about the perturbed Schwarzschild horizons in second-order perturbation theory. This is part of my thesis project that I'm doing with Adam Pound. The LISA mission will open a new era for the gravitational wave astronomy. We will have new data from systems that cannot be reached by the ground-based gravitational wave detectors. So we could have a very accurate prediction for the binary models. Also, one of the main aims of the LISA mission is to understand the nature and the properties of the supermassive black holes. We are interested in a particular class of binary systems, so which are the EMRIs, the extreme-mass-ratio-inspirals. These systems are made by a supermassive black hole plus a compact object, which usually is a stellar massive black hole or a neutron star that is orbiting around the supermassive black hole. Thanks to the extreme mass ratio, we could define a perturbative parameter epsilon. So we use the self-force theory to understand the physics of the EMRIs, and we could achieve a consistent expansion up to the second order for the quantities involved in the EMRI physics. And also we could have an accurate description for the perturbed horizons of the central supermassive black hole. We are interested in studying the central black hole because it is fundamental to understand the physics of the black holes that reside in the galactic cores. We are going to look at the simplest case, which is the Schwarzschild black holes. This is the step also used in the calculation for the second order gravitational binding energy for compact binaries. In this paper, the authors evaluate the reducible mass using the apparent horizon, and we are going to evaluate the reducible mass also using the event horizon, and we are going to make a comparison between the two results. And thanks to the second order in epsilon, so to this accurate description, we could actually make a comparison between different models and different definitions in general relativity. So the horizon surface could be parameterized by these coordinates, where RH is the horizon radius, and usually it depends on the time and the angular coordinates. As we could see here, the Z border is just 2m because we assume Schwarzschild as a background manifold. The intrinsic metric is described by gamma AB, and here we have the Schwarzschild metric in Eddington-Pinkelstein-ingoing coordinates. Then we have the perturbation metric and the vectors tangent to the horizon surface. So we could evaluate the area thanks to the integral in expression 4, and we could easily relate the area to the irreducible mass by equation 5. So always when I talk about the area, we keep in mind that we could relate the area to the irreducible mass by equation 5. Then we have the area expressed at the second order in epsilon in equation 6. Here I don't want to go into technical details, but I just want to point out the main feature of these features of this expression, which are we have the terms involving the perturbation metric and terms involving the perturbation of the radius. So until here the expression are generic, them holds for both the horizons, and now we need to evaluate the perturbation of the radius in terms of the perturbation of the metric. Here I also notice here that we have some LM labels which are referred to a tensorial spherical harmonic expansion that we've made in order to evaluate the integral for the area. The radius at first order we need the full LM components. Instead, for the second order we just need the spherically symmetric part, which is the 0-0 term. So I just recall briefly how to define the event horizon and the apparent horizon. We describe the event horizon as a congruence of null geodesic. And so for the tangent vector, it holds a null relation. Moreover, to understand where it is, the event horizon, we need to know the full history of the manifold. So basically, we assume that in the late future, the spacetime will behave as a stationary spacetime. So the system ends as a curved black hole. Then we could trace back in time the location of the event horizon. Instead, the apparent horizon is defined locally. And on the apparent horizon surface, the scalar, the expansion scalar is zero. This expansion scalar is given by the covariant divergence of a null vector field normal to the surface and pointing outward. I just remark that for the zero order, so in the background, we have a Schwarzschild manifold, and so the event horizon and the apparent horizon coincide and are a sphere of radius 2m. Evaluating the expression for the event horizon, at first order, we get the differential equation expressed in equation 9. At second order, we get a longer expression, but I rewrite it in a compact form. And basically, we have some second order terms and then quadratic terms in the first order perturbations. These two expressions could be both recast in a form of equation 11, which is a differential equation for the event horizon radius, and then I put all the other terms inside the term that I call f. This kind of equation has a so-called teleological solution, which is given in an integral form, plus a condition on the infinity, and that's why we call it teleological. And as I said before, we assume that the systems end as a curved black hole. So in order to evaluate the event horizon radius at one instant in time, we need to evaluate this integral. Instead for the apparent horizon, since it is a local quantity, we could immediately solve the equations. And at first order, we get equation 13. Instead for the second order, we get a very long expression that I write in a compact form in equation 14. Here I show the general structure, which is quite simple. We have two linear terms in the second order metric, and then we have quadratic terms in the first order perturbations. So now we would like to make a comparison between the results for the apparent horizon and the event horizon, but in order to do that, we need to make some further assumption. We are going to look at the two timescale expansion, because we are interested in the EMRIs, and the quasi-circular orbit regime is an interesting regime for the EMRIs, and also the authors in the binding energy paper use this regime to evaluate the binding energy. In this regime, the system evolves with two characteristic times. V tilde, which is the slow time, and this time gives the variation on the radiation reaction time scale, so on the long time scale. Then we have a phi, the fast time, which is associated to the orbital time scale and gives the variation on the short time scale. Now we could make some assumption on the fields, and we assume that they are periodic in the fast time with a frequency omega, and that they are bounded in the slow time. Thanks to the assumption we made, we could actually apply the two timescale expansion for this regime, and then also apply a Fourier expansion. Here I take the label Lm and K, but for the quasi-circular orbit regime, M and K, they coincide. Moreover, we see that in expression 15, the right-hand side term, which is the Fourier expanded expression, we have the two time dependence that are splitted, and this allows us to compute easily the derivatives. And this expression holds for every field, not just for the radius. So applying in order to apply the this expansion to the event horizon, we need to specialize the system to the ones that evolve to have zero angular momentum and total mass m at late times. This assumption is needed in order to approximate both the equation for the event horizon and the solution that we've seen for the event horizon. So we could safely apply the two-time scale expansion and we get equation 16 at first order. And if we apply the same expansion to the apparent horizon solution, we get equation 17. These are generically different, but if we look at the L equal to zero components, we get exactly the same solution. At second order, we get very long expression. So we write this solution in a compact form, which is shown is equation 18 and 19. These two equations differs by two terms. The first difference is the about the sum that runs for L more than zero, and then we have the other difference, which is given by these low time derivative terms. Since the terms for L more than zero decay quite fast, we expect that this low time derivative is the main difference in the second order spherically symmetric location for the event horizon and the apparent horizon. It's also quite remarkable that we obtain some local solution for the event horizon, which generically is a non-local quantity. Now we could plug all the expression inside the area and then evaluate the reducible mass, and we could actually evaluate the difference in the reducible mass. In the plot that we see here, we see the difference in the reducible mass plotted against the orbital radius. We plug data for the quasi-circular orbits, and we see that going near the ISCO, the difference increase. And also, this contribution is entirely given by this low time derivative term, as we expected. Indeed, the quadratic terms gives a contribution of orders 10 to the minus 21, which is very small with respect of the scale of this plot. Then we could make some assumption for the mass ratio. For example, we could assume a supermassive black hole of about 10 to the 5 solar masses and a compact object of about 10 solar masses. Using this assumption, we obtain a maximum difference near the ISCO of about 10 to the minus 8 solar masses. This difference translates in a difference in terms of areal radius of about 10 to the minus 5 meters. This is a very, very small difference, but it's quite remarkable that thanks to the second order in epsilon, we actually could evaluate this difference. So I just recap the results that we got. We obtained the location for the event horizon and the apparent horizon up to the second order in epsilon. And then also we have an expression for the area up to the second order. We could use this expression to evaluate the reducible mass and specialize it to the quasi-circular orbit regime up to the second order, and we made a comparison. Our future prospects are to compute the gauge transformation up to the second order and to derive the perturbation also for the angular momentum, which is the other fundamental property of the astrophysical black holes. We could also study and compare our results with other definitions of mass that we have in general relativity. That's all, and thank you.